informed views are saying about this election, and also how the sort of prediction models work. We're going to start seeing the prediction models a little later in this election. As some of the results come in, some people are actually going to be making predictions of it. So joining us tonight, we have Angelo Fick, a well-known analyst, director of the Elwell Socioeconomic Research Institute, Professor Nkobisi Ntletiana, a professor of politics at the University of Johannesburg, and from the CSIR, Dr. Zaid Kimi joins us as well. Gentlemen, good evening. Thank you very much indeed for joining us. Professor Ntletiana, if I could start with you. I suppose in a way it's been a typical South African election. One or two problems, most people in pretty good spirits, almost everybody who wanted to vote got to vote, and generally we now wait for the result.
The usual protest here and there, one or two boxes lost, five or so voting stations not open, but overall and comparatively speaking, I think it's been a good day because we have more than 22,000 voting stations. So if you have five not open on time, really, you know, you can't quite complain. And also some of these boxes, at times, you can trace them. In 2014, we had all sorts of boxes being lost and people thought that, you know, the elections were rigged. At the end of it, we realized that actually these boxes could be traced. So good job for the IEC, but some of the mistakes are quite elementary. Right, you understand that you're dealing with staff of about 190,000, 22,000 voting stations. Yes, it's a massive operation, but some of the mistakes are pretty much unforgivable, elementary stuff. So hopefully, you know, certain things can be learned from this and not be repeated.
Angelo, are you more forgiving than Professor Ntletiana?
More forgiving. I think for me, this election, many people expected there to be a lot more drama. And so I think there's a lot of disappointment. I think much of the drama has to do with how technology has shifted over the elections. And so the way in which social media is used by, or are used by, politicians and their followers to do things that I think are going to become more and more irresponsible as time goes on. Because people are already questioning issues that they really should be using the official mechanisms to do. So if they have videos of things that they think have gone wrong, the responsible thing to do is to send that to the IEC and follow the usual process. But by putting it out on social media, of course, you are indicating that should the result not go quite how you thought it would, you could use this as a kind of way of justifying why you think the election results are bad. And so responsible use of social media platforms by particularly party political officials might become something to look to in the elections beyond this one.
Now, there's a whole night's worth of conversation about social media and cynicism right there. All right, we'll come back to this because I think it's a very important issue. I want to talk about predictions a little bit now. And Dr. Kimi, you're with the CSIR. You produce some of these predictions. You have mathematical models. There's a reason why I'm doing this and not a maths professor. How exactly do these work, right? As I understand it, you know, one or two a couple of voting stations can report and you immediately start making predictions. How on earth do you do that?
Well, a couple of voting stations, yeah. The very first voting station that comes in, we can generate a prediction. But that prediction is pretty much nonsense. So we do need some weight of numbers of voting stations to report. And we think anywhere between 3 and 5% gives us a very good chance of nailing the final result. How it's done? It's simple mathematics, really. If you believe that people voted randomly, you know, you woke up in the morning, you tossed a couple of dice, or you flipped a couple of coins and decided who you'd vote for, then none of these prediction algorithms would work. But because people have reasons for how they vote, and we think there are factors behind their choices, once a certain threshold of people have registered their choices, we can extrapolate from those to others in similar situations and believe that we can have a decent chance of saying how the final result will turn out.
Okay, that sort of 5% of the vote that you need, do you need a spread of the country? I mean, do you need suburban, township, urban, rural to develop that model? Or is it even so sophisticated it doesn't need that?
Well, part of why we need the 5% is we're assuming that 5% won't only be rural voting districts in the Eastern Cape. If that were the case, we would be in some trouble, but that hasn't ever happened yet. So the voting stations reported differential rates, But we think at about 5% enough different voting stations have reported that we'll have a handle on getting that final result right.
Okay, I mean, something like this, I mean, on the one level, it can be a bit risky. I mean, your reputation could literally go out the window. There are a couple of pollsters who might have that problem in the next little while. But at the same time, what you're also doing is creating a set of data which could be compared with the final set of data from the Electoral Commission. Now, we're quite a cynical country in some ways, but in a situation, and this is not the case here, let me stress, but in a situation in which results were going to be contested, you would have two sets of data to interrogate. I presume that makes your data quite valuable.
Yeah, in fact, in 1994, when this modelling process started, it was a far more chaotic election. You'll recall no voters' rolls, various forms of identification required. The IEC asked the CSIR to check post-fact whether there were anomalous results from voting stations. And using that basic set of research, we were able to develop the algorithm. So its initial reason for being was in fact to check for fraud or illegitimate results. We didn't find any in 1994, and I'm pretty sure there'll be none in 2019.
It's very interesting. I mean, Angelo, do you think that when you've got someone predicting results, I mean, does it take some of the fun out of it, or is there a value in creating that second set of data?
Well, I think, firstly, the word prediction might allow some people to believe that, you know, it is prediction. Mm. And I think the technical term there for me was extrapolation. Mm. It's based on data, it's based on a statistical model, and so it's only prediction in its technical sense that it's suggesting that based on these results, those results are likely to be. I don't think it's a spoil at all. I think what it does allow is for people to prepare themselves, and also that there is all sorts of other pieces of information or data generated by that process that becomes useful in a scientific process, both during and after. And so there is the science that has to be respected. And those of us who look at it and go, oh, it's a bit like knowing what you're going to get for Christmas or for Hanukkah or for whatever, that's neither here nor there. The science, I think, is important because what it does is produces large sets of data that can be used comparatively from election to election that now goes back 25 years and that is useful for people who want to do research on voting patterns, voting behavior, and statistical analysis.
I suppose, Professor Ntlediana, it's one of those situations, the more data you have, the more valuable it is.
The important thing is why people vote the way they do. There are a lot of variables that we are very keen to follow. For instance, there's been a lot of prediction about white voters, for instance, voting for Cyril Ramaphosa. So of the support that the ANC will get, assuming it wins, the interesting question would be, did it get that support from across a wide racial spectrum, right? So we'll go into areas that are predominantly white and check how those voting stations voted. So you will have the results inevitably, even without their predictions, right? That's a given. But the more interesting thing is the analytical value out of that. Why do people vote the way they do, right? You might have an EFF scoring about 17%, 18%. That tells you about a surge, continuing surge of populism. Where is it happening? Why? So if you have that surge of populism, then that tells you that there's something wrong with the system, right? That, you know, you are looking at a few problems ahead. So the why part of it, for me, is quite interesting. Well, for political parties to know that they've won or not, it's a lot of excitement. But for scholars, the data that comes of that to answer the why, it's even more interesting.
Dr. Kimmy, I mean, when you try and assemble this data, how many people do you need to do it, or do you just need a really fancy laptop?
Well, you'd be surprised at the number of things that can go wrong, even with what's ostensibly quite a simple process. So there's a team of about 7 or 8 people, programmers and applied mathematicians. And, you know, the model isn't static. We test it and we try and improve it. And yeah, you know, in some ways it can be considered frivolous, in the sense that if we all just sat back and waited, then the results would come to us. We don't need the intermediate step. But human beings have a natural aversion to uncertainty, which is why people have horoscopes and fortune tellers and the like. So this, I think, fills a gap. In the period where there's some uncertainty about what the result is going to be, we can fill that knowledge gap by saying, well, it's not that uncertain. We think we know where we're going.
We're going to go back to the floor in a moment, and Nzwa Ndile Mbeje is standing by. But yeah. Professor Ndile, I do want to put this to you. Okay, around the country now, probably all in Joburg somewhere, are a group, different groups of politicians, all working on what I would call their post-election spin. Right. So they're trying to work out how well they've done, and they're trying to get their excuses ready, or their victory speeches ready, or their "Oh my gosh, I've actually won, and what do I do now?" ready. I would imagine a model like this is very useful. You get 24 hours notice of what's going to happen. I mean, it's interesting to me that there aren't any very senior political leaders here now, because they don't want to. They don't want anyone to capture their face when some of the results come in.
Well, the last time around in 2016, the CSIR called it around 10, saying the ANC would lose Tshwane, Joburg, and PE. No one wanted to believe that, right? So their speeches were not ready, and I think some of them disputed those predictions, right? But for now, well, I guess there are no excuses, David. Well, people will come up with rain as an excuse, that the IEC voting station is not opening. Might be another excuse. But ultimately, though, the operation has been perfect. It's been a work of art. So they have no reason to dispute anything other than simply accept.
All right. Nzwa Ndile, we're going to go to you in a sec. I do want to just do this. I'm going to stand up and just see if we have any results yet, because we can hit the refresh button. And you can watch this with me. So we'll just click on there. We'll hit the enter button. Total valid votes, I'm afraid, is still zero. All right. Nzwa Ndile Mbeje, you're on the floor. You're standing next to Jeff Khadebe, I believe, the Minister of Energy. Nzwa Ndile, good evening once again.
Oh yes, Stephen. I guess in the next few hours, so he will still be as welcome.